is on. Well, I guess I'll go ahead and start again since we're recording now. So, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Stephanie Meyer. I serve as a special assistant to Secretary Val Arkush at the Pennsylvania Department of Human Services, where I focus on housing, homelessness, and our related partnerships in that space. At the request of the Eastern COC and Western COC, we were asked to give a presentation today on mainstream benefits. I know for many of you, this is HUD NOFO season, and you have just a few more days until you can hopefully get some more sleep and be able to put the NOFO behind you for a long while until we get awards notifications. So thank you for all that you do. And we just wanted to share a few updates from my end that I thought would be of interest to this group. And then I'm going to pass to my colleague, Heather, who will really go through the lion's share and heart of the presentation today. So I'll go ahead and hit share on a screen here. Let me just go ahead and see. Here we go. Okay.
Stephanie, I think you're muted. Can you hear me?
Okay, that is now hopefully fixed. So for DHS Housing Supports and Priorities, it's a Monday, everyone. So I wanted to note that just for DHS, we have a variety of supports, resources, and programs across all of our departments that help folks with housing, as well as services for those who need it. And our priorities are supporting folks who are experiencing homelessness or at risk of homelessness, folks who live in institutions such as nursing facilities, but who could live in the community, and folks with low incomes and households who are rent burdened. We know that a lot of our Pennsylvania neighbors and many folks who we care about are often paying a very high proportion of their monthly income towards rent costs. Down the road, we wanted to let you know that we have some really big things in the works and just put them on your radar. The DHS housing page here is a hyperlink, and it links to our main page and goes through a prior iteration, the first version of our DHS housing strategic plan, a five-year plan. We'll be spending a lot of time over the next year coming up with a new plan and setting new priorities, activities, and we'll be working to engage with folks around the state to really inform and make sure that we know the needs and how we can best support our neighbors. So I wanted to put that on the radar because you can bookmark that page, and any announcements about big pieces, we'll make sure to go there and how you can partner with us in that. We are working on some big initiatives to address social determinants of health and health-related social needs within our state Medicaid programs through the submission of an 1115 waiver to CMS that could address housing and tenancy supports. We're really excited about that and moving quickly on it. And I wanted to note here that Homes Within Reach, our partners with the Housing Alliance of Pennsylvania, they have a big conference every year in December. And we will be there on day three, having a big engagement session around this DHS housing strategic plan, and also publicly presenting on our plan for an 1115 waiver and housing supports through the Medicaid program. So lots of excitement about that, and wanted to make sure folks knew how to register so that they could connect down the road. The one other piece I'll note here, I like to let folks in the continuum of care world know about the Pennsylvania Property Tax and Rent Rebate Program. It is through our sister department, the Department of Revenue, but it's one I consistently find that a lot of folks over time maybe forget about, or maybe they didn't know about it in the first place. And folks who are enrolled in homeless services programs, but paying a portion of their rent, are eligible to apply if they are 50 and up, folks with disabilities, and certain seniors. So wanted to note that this is another hyperlink that folks can check out for more details. And then on this, you will receive the PowerPoint slides, but just wanted to note that there are some free resources available to you that we fund through the Self-Determination Housing of Pennsylvania Regional Housing Coordinator Program. These are completely zero cost trainings available to you and any other professionals in order to help grow knowledge and help folks understand how to better support the folks that they work with every day. And there's also an information and referral link. It's a Microsoft form. You can fill it out in less than 3 minutes and someone from SCHP will follow up with you to help you with your needs. And last, but certainly not least, I wanted to note that our Office of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Services is currently hiring for a housing specialist position. This is a really critical position. I work with the folks at OMSOS quite a bit and helps expand access to permanent supportive housing for folks with serious mental illness and those who use substances in Pennsylvania. So help us get the word out. I hope we'll get some great applicants. And that is open through 10-4. And my last slide here, just a few resources that I find folks are really interested in over time. And we'll have Helen share these out so that they can be helpful down the road. So really appreciate the time today. And Heather, I'll be happy to hand it over to you to talk about mainstream benefits in Pennsylvania.
Thank you, Stephanie. Okay, everyone. I am Heather Solly. I am actually a staff development specialist, and I work for the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, just as Stephanie does. DHS, I work for the Office of Income Maintenance, however, and I am involved with the onboarding and training of all newly hired caseworkers. So there is a standard training program that every single caseworker that's hired through the Commonwealth has to go through before they can even touch our benefits. I do take part in that, and I also work with other caseworkers within the field on doing professional development and trainings as such. So hopefully the information I've brought to you all today gives you a little higher level insight as to what benefits and supports we do offer at DHS, which are way more than, you know, the SNAP, the medical assistance, and the cash that you typically just hear of. So give me 1 second. I'm going to go ahead and start sharing my screen. There we go. You all able to view my screen then? Oh, I'm in the wrong one. Or... Okay, good. You can see benefits and supportive services. Yeah, I'm a seasoned Teams user, but not as much as with Zoom. So today I'm going to go over a high-level overview of the benefits and also supportive services that are offered by DHS, specifically through our County Assistance Office, which is supported through the Office of Income Maintenance. Me, I am Heather Jo Solly. I go by Heather. I recently got married in January, and my sister-in-law has the same name as me, so we just, for professional name, I just add the Joe onto my name, but you all can call me Heather. And my contact information is right there on the slide, hsolly@pa.gov. Today's presentation is going to go follow the format that you see on the screen. A good way to kind of get in or delve into public assistance benefits is to kind of start at the beginning. How do I apply? So as you can see here, I have on my slide here that I'm going to start off on how does somebody request assistance. And then I'm going to go into much detail on each of the different programs, our food assistance, which is our SNAP program, medical assistance, cash assistance, and I'm going to go deeper into these programs to see what each of these, or to tell you what each of these programs have available, because there's much more, especially like this isn't just food assistance. There's much more that we can go beyond that. But to get us all started, there are many different ways to apply for benefits. So when we're talking about public assistance benefits, and this would be any kind of benefits and any kind of support, the probably most obvious way would be to apply in person. Anyone can go into any county assistance office and pick up an application and complete that right in the office and turn it in right there. Now, sometimes people are not aware of where their local county assistance office is. So I just have some information for you all. If you go on to the DHS.PA.gov website, you can see here that this also says, how do I apply for benefits? So I'm actually going to see if I can post this into the chat here. I don't think I'm going to be able to with the way it's set up here. But this is the way, this is a landing page for DHS, and this absolutely goes through, there's a link to it on my slide as well, goes through the different ways that you can apply. If somebody is not aware of where their county assistance office is, they can actually get a list of county assistance offices right here online. So it actually gives the address, the phone numbers, and even the office hours. I also have a document that I have a list of CAOs, which not has the same information, the faxes, and the executive directors as well. I can absolutely share this out with you all. Also, this is an older contact, not an older contact flyer, but this also is a way that we can kind of get that information out there on how to apply for benefits outside of going into an office. So it talks about the online, the phone, and it also gives the statewide customer service center and the mailing address. So I really like this. The only thing I would caution about this is we currently have SNAP interviews waived, and we'll talk about that in just a little bit here. But back to my slide, like I said, an individual can go in person and just pick up an application in any county assistance office. Individuals can also apply for medical assistance in SNAP, which is our food stamp program, via telephone. So that number you'll see right on your slide. And there will be somebody that will assist with completing the application right there on through a phone call. So that's that 866-550-4355. And as always, another option that's out there is our Compass website. So it's www.compass.state.us. And the Compass website, I really think, is phenomenal. And I'm just going to show you this because it honestly is an online application system for any and all of our benefits, but it, as you can see, you know, goes right through the application process. You can actually, as any kind of community service agencies, can work with your clients or customers to go through this process, because sometimes the online application process can be a little confusing. And what I really like on the Compass website is that it also goes through different services that OIM and DHS offers that are even outside of what a county assistance office would be able to work with. Okay, so I really, really, really like that. Those are just the three ways to apply. And again, the paper application that I referred to is going to be your Pennsylvania application for benefits. We internally at OIM refer to this as the PA600. This is a standard application that someone can use to apply for any type of benefit that's offered through the county assistance office, be it cash assistance, SNAP food stamp benefits, medical assistance. Also, there, and we'll talk about this when we go into medical assistance, the county assistance offices are now determining eligibility for CHIP. So this application can absolutely be used to apply for CHIP as well. That's one of the great things that we have recently added. And again, this is the Compass website, and I kind of demonstrated to you how to access that. On this slide, it's going to basically say that if somebody, because we are going into the SNAP program first, if somebody wants to apply for SNAP, which is our food stamps program. If they get an application, either the paper or the online Compass application, into the office, and they have very little to no income and resources, when I say resources, I mean like cash or bank accounts, money that is easy liquid, that can be liquidated for use easily. Sometimes individuals can be eligible for what we call expedited SNAP services. And essentially what that means is a caseworker will get that application, evaluate it, and it will be processed and available to that individual so they can use them within 5 days. Okay, so if they're eligible, Not everybody's eligible for these services, but we can absolutely, we always screen every application that comes in to see if someone meets this criteria. I heard somebody cough. I didn't know if that was a question or just off mute. So that's the expedited SNAP. Other than that, if someone is not eligible for expedited SNAP, caseworkers do have a processing deadline of 30 calendar days. Okay, so that means the longest, as long as we have everything we need to process that application, the longest somebody should be waiting for benefits should be that 30 calendar days. Okay, and I'm going to give you some tips at the end of my presentation that you can utilize to work with your employees with the populations you serve to give them tips on how to get their application as processed as quickly as possible. All caseworkers do process applications the order in which they come in. However, certain things can expedite the process. Okay, if you have everything and you need there, you're going to get your benefits a little quicker. Any questions on the application process before I move in to focus specifically on our food assistance program, which is also known as SNAP? And Seth, I'm sorry, and Helen, I can't see the chat. So if you see something pop up there, please let me know.
Yeah, there's just what you've talked about a bit. I've been told by CAO people I shouldn't go there to apply anymore. I should do paper, phone, or online. Is that still the case? And then others are like chiming in about, I always suggest dropping completed apps off to the office.
Yeah, I mean, seriously, going in to complete your application, you're gonna sit there. I haven't been in a CIO because I work with staff development since pre-COVID. So pre-COVID, it was great. You went in, you could actually be seen at that time. However, now because the office is closed for a little bit and then reopened, probably the fastest way would be to have that application already completed and just drop it off at the assistance office or use the Compass website. Yes, I agree with what's being said.
And then someone said, can you apply on Compass specifically for payment of Medicare premiums, coinsurance, and deductibles program?
Absolutely. Okay. So we'll talk about that in much detail when I get to the medical assistance about those different programs. And that would be just if you were on the Compass website, you would just request medical assistance. And then we could look at absolutely if you have Medicare Part B copays and things of that sort, you could absolutely be reviewed for that by just selecting medical assistance. Great question. Great question.
Okay. And then the last one was it just came in. Can you explain the expedited process again?
Absolutely. So if somebody, there are certain criteria individuals, expedited is out there. It's meant to help individuals who have very little to no income or resources available to purchase food. So every time we get an application in for the SNAP program, the day we get it, we review it for expedited services. And what expedited services are, if SNAP, I explain it, the easiest way to understand it is SNAP in a hurry. You get that SNAP, an individual who applies, who is eligible, will have those food stamp benefits on an EBT card and have an EBT card in hand within 5 days and be able to use them if they are eligible. And essentially what makes someone eligible would be looking at their income. Is their income low enough? Do they have an income only coming in the household of $100 or less? Okay, so very low, little to no income. Do they have no checking, nothing in their checking account? So we're looking at things like that. It's also available to migrant and seasonal farm workers. And another thing out there is if somebody applies for benefits and their household expenses, like their rent and their utilities, way exceed what they are bringing in as far as income, then that would be another circumstance that could allow for the possibility for someone to be eligible for that quick SNAP.
Okay. Thank you. And then let's see, can you apply for benefits on Compass using a cell phone?
That is a very good question. We have an app now. So there is an app that individuals can use to upload documents who are already open in benefits. So that's the app. You can't apply through the app. Cell phone usage, you can absolutely pull up the Compass app, the Compass website on like the cell phone browser. However, I caution that the Compass website was developed for an actual computer web browser. So it may be a little more difficult just to navigate on a cell phone just because of the fitting. But you absolutely can access the site through a cell phone, the internet. Yep, great question.
Great, thanks. And I do have another question, but before I ask, I just typed in the chat. If folks can start using the Q&A function instead of the chat, that will be easier because people are still saying where they're from and questions can get lost in the shuffle. So this way we'll be sure that we don't miss any of your questions. Please use the Q&A function. The one that I see left in the chat is how often can someone apply for emergency SNAP benefits?
Oh, that is another excellent question. So emergency SNAP benefits are how they work is if it's not really, you're not applying for emergency SNAP benefits. Anytime you apply for SNAP benefits, you are evaluated for emergency SNAP benefits. So probably the best way for me to explain this would be to give an example. Let's say I go to the county assistance office and I apply for SNAP today, and they determine that I'm eligible for expedited SNAP. However, I need to verify something. Maybe I need to bring in my pay stub. So I got that expedited SNAP issuance, but the county assistance office is waiting on some verification for me. But I never bring in that. So the only thing I get is that expedited SNAP. If I go in and apply 6 months from now, I'm still going to have to get that verification in. Therefore, I would not be able to get that expedited issuance because the county assistance office is waiting on something from me, if that makes sense.
Great, thank you. And then another question that came through, how does someone apply to increase their SNAP benefits? I have a homeless client who is receiving $58 a month.
Oh boy, that's a great question. So utilizing the Compass website or even to access their benefits, to access their account and updating income would probably be one way, would probably be probably the quickest way. Another way, does the homeless individual that you're working with, do they have income or like
Yes, they have Social Security income.
okay, perfect, perfect. So, yeah, I would suggest maybe if there's any changes in the Social Security, updating that income. Other than that, you could absolutely have your individual with whom you're working maybe call their caseworker, calling the statewide customer service center, talking to a caseworker to see if there are any other possible ways. Typically, when somebody does get SSI, that doesn't fluctuate. But if there are fluctuations or if somebody loses it, there are ways that the benefits can increase. And there is actually going to be a cost of living adjustment that is coming here October 1st. So SNAP benefits will go up a little bit. They will go up a little bit. Another way for a homeless individual that I just thought of would be maybe if that individual has any type of that they have to make any payment for their shelter, if they're staying in a homeless shelter and they make any payment, that would be another way to report that as well. Very good questions.
Yeah, so this one is interesting. I've actually never thought of it in like all of my years doing this work. Should SNAP benefits be reduced when a homeless individual is admitted into a homeless shelter because food is accessible?
I'm gonna have to write that one down and get back to you on that, because that could be answered in a multitude of ways. Yeah, that's a pretty deep question. Can you repeat that for me? Because I'm gonna have to really look into policy on that, and I don't feel comfortable answering that with just, like a quick answer.
Right. Yeah. I'll email it to you
Okay.
so that you
Yeah.
have the exact words. And then someone says, I have someone who, let me see, is this, okay, so this is a totally different question. So I will email that question to you. Actually, I'll email any of the questions to you that can't be addressed right now.
Okay.
There's another one. Kenyatta is asking, I have someone who's trying to collect their case, contact their caseworker and is unable to. Every time they call the office, they are requesting they speak with their assigned caseworker. What's the proper chain of command?
If they're not getting a hold of their caseworker, I would suggest to talk to that caseworker supervisor. Another, if they can't, the supervisor above that would be a manager, but I would start with the supervisor. Supervisors usually, our caseworkers are very busy right now. However, that's not an excuse to that's not an excuse not to be available. So usually if you contact the supervisor will get the caseworker to contact that individual back. Also, again, utilizing our statewide customer service center is a great tool because our workers are their actual caseworkers that work at that statewide customer service center. A lot of times they can make the changes right then and there that your caseworker actually could. And if they can't, they actually will put in a direct contact to that caseworker. So that case it'll appear on caseworkers have something called a dashboard. It'll appear on there as a work item. So not only will a caseworker see that appear and have to address it, but also that caseworker supervisor and chain of command. So great question.
Great. There are a few more. And then I also saw Stephanie hop on video. So, Stephanie, did you have anything to add for anything that was discussed?
I would note that I do think getting a specifically the question on the food stamp benefits and writing in the policy would be helpful just because I know the answer is often it depends. But historically, when I've seen folks from the Office of Income Maintenance and the policy team respond to this question in the past, it has depended upon the level of meals provided. And we often know that like there are a number of emergency shelters who may say, I provide dinner, but I don't provide breakfast and lunch every day or things of that nature. So it is usually depended upon the meals provided with a lot of nuance to that in essence. But if someone has all meals provided, then likely they should have their SNAP benefit reduced or potentially paused. But a more nuanced answer would be appropriate depending upon the particular situation. So I'll leave that to Heather and team when you have that in writing.
Great.
Thank
Thanks, Stephanie. And there is an anonymous attendee who kind of echoes this and says, in my experience, not all shelters or transitional housing provide meals.
you.
So
Yeah,
just
absolutely.
acknowledging that comment. So there are quite a few questions here. I'll go through them one by one. Can two individuals in the same household be receiving SNAP benefits?
Like separately? Is that what it is?
Beverly, if you could confirm in the chat if that's what you meant, and I'll go on to the next question. If someone has special dietary needs, can the SNAP account be increased due to increased cost of special nutritional needs?
Can it be increased because of special nutritional needs?
Yeah, I guess I'm thinking like, gluten-free could be more money or, whatever.
Yeah. Well, there's a maximum SNAP grant for however many people that are going to be applying together. Okay. So we can never exceed what that maximum SNAP grant is. We do take into consideration specific deductions that can come off. So if somebody would be, per se, let's say like disabled and they have a special diet because of that, and this is like a monthly medical expense that can be verified, that could be something that could be turned into a caseworker, and the caseworker could look to see if that could be a deduction that would increase the SNAP benefit.
Okay, great.
A lot
Thank
of these
you.
seem like they're coming about SNAP, and I'm going to actually go in detail into SNAP, so if there I can address a lot of those then.
Okay, so then let me see what else we can. I'll put on hold then the SNAP questions. Let me see if there's other ones. So I guess maybe I'm not exactly sure what Samantha's talking about in terms of applying, maybe for benefits in general. Would refugee families be able to apply that are found homeless in our county? And if so, how do they go about it?
Okay, so the same way anybody else would. We actually have some separate programs for refugees. There is refugee cash assistance out there. And again, I would never discourage anybody from applying. We do evaluate citizenship for each individual, but again, there are specific programs aimed directly at refugees, especially since there's more and more policy coming in to address the needs and for benefits for this population. So I would highly encourage if anybody's a refugee, just to get an application, apply for it, select application for medical assistance, SNAP, and cash, because there's always that option that could be available to that individual, and the caseworker will determine eligibility. May need some extra verification on that. I do know refugees are coming in as, non-citizens, refugees, so they would have to verify their immigration status. So, that would be, there's a lot of nuances with that, but again, I would encourage application, either Compass or PA600.
Okay, great. I have two generic questions, it appears. Please say again how to check benefits if when a client's income changes and update their info. Can a case manager do that online with the client?
Oh, that's a great question. So the caseworker, if you can get a hold of your caseworker, absolutely, the caseworker can make the updates in the system. And if, let's say, somebody's income decreases, absolutely, they can change the income in the system, which will adjust their SNAP benefits. Whether it be, maybe they lost their job, so that would increase. You want to encourage reporting, especially, changes in income like that, because those really have a impact on your SNAP, on your benefits. The quickest way to report changes would be to either use the Compass website. So if you are actually already open in benefits, you can see there's this login register. So you can actually log, you, if they're open in benefits, they can log in on Compass and they can report changes, upload documents. And the greatest thing, not only the greatest thing about the new mobile app we have is the mobile app's even better for updating changes, because an individual can actually take their mobile device, take a picture of whatever that verification is, and send it directly through the mobile app. So the mobile app is a very good tool for getting those changes reported quickly. It immediately goes to the caseworker, so they get that.
Great. And also, if this person was referring to like their case manager, maybe in a shelter or behavioral health case manager, like of course they can do anything with, an individual could do anything with their own case manager. So that would work there as well. So that was answered. Hold on, that's SNAP. On a Compass application, should the client enter their gross or net income?
We always go off of gross, but then there are multiple deductions depending on the program that can be taken off. So any expenses that it asks for on Compass, you definitely want to encourage those questions to be answered, because the different programs have different deductions. Again, we always go off the gross income, but again, every program has its own set of deductions. So gross income. Yeah, we're looking at gross first, and then we're gonna reduce that as much as we can.
Okay, there is a question here about emergency shelter allowance. Is that something that'll be addressed later on, or do you want that question now?
Absolutely. I have an in-depth slide actually on the emergency shelter allowance, so I'm going to give you a ton of information on that. That is a very, very good program that kind of goes along with our cash assistance program. I have it set up to be discussed in there.
Okay, great. So then I'll keep this question up just in case it's not answered later. Sean, if you hear that this question was answered while Heather's talking, please just indicate in the chat so that we can resolve the question. With that, we got to the end of the questions. Go ahead, Heather.
I love this because there's so many great questions, and it seems like there's so much enthusiasm to get this information. Which leads me to believe it's something that's needed. The community really needs this information. So hopefully you all can pass this out, and we can help, the populations we're working with to get, more support, more benefits. Because, recently with the public health emergency ending, a lot of individuals lost a lot of extra support for food. So that kind of like leads me into us to me talking about food stamps or our SNAP program. That's our hunger prevention program. This legacy was known as food stamps because at one point the individuals did not get an electronic EBT card, which they do now, and they were actually paper coupons, but we have since long time gotten rid of those. So it is now called SNAP, which is the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. Essentially, the purpose of the program is to offer benefits specifically for food and food-related items that are meant to supplement the food budget for families who qualify. It's promoted to purchase healthy food and move towards self-sufficiency. With that being said, there are other programs within the SNAP program that can help towards that social self-sufficiency. One of the biggest things that's asked is who can apply. If you're a resident of Pennsylvania, you can absolutely apply for SNAP. Okay. An applicant has to meet certain requirements to be eligible for SNAP benefits, though. So we look at a couple different things that we call common eligibility factors when we are reviewing anybody for the food stamp of the SNAP program. We need to look at the residency. This is important because the individual has to be applying in the county in which they reside. Now, we request verification of that. However, when we're working with a population like those that are chronically homeless or maybe, they're going from home to home and verification of their residency may be difficult, this is one requirement in that circumstance that can be waived. So, we do require the verification that you are a resident of that county, but there are many different ways we can request verification of that. The biggest one, maybe with a homeless population, could be somebody that knows them, so the collateral contact. But if there is nothing out there to verify that residency, if somebody is homeless, we're not going to deny them because of just residency only. It also says citizenship criteria must be met. Now, that doesn't mean that if you're not a US citizen, you can't access the SNAP program. That means if you're a citizen, you state on your application, I am a US citizen. Our system does match with multiple agencies out there in the government, so we can verify that citizenship electronically. However, if we do have non-citizens applying, as I addressed a little bit earlier, they would have to declare that they're non-citizen, and then we need verification of their non-citizen status. There are eligible non-citizens, so there are two steps a caseworker would take when they're determining eligibility for a non-citizen. First, they determine from the verification that they're given, is that person an eligible non-citizen? Now, that has been opened up quite recently, immensely. Okay, so there are many different criteria out there that an individual could meet who is not a citizen to be eligible for SNAP. Once that, are they an eligible non-citizen is determined, and if somebody is determined an eligible non-citizen, then the caseworkers look to see if they would have to have a waiting period for SNAP or if they could get it immediately. There's something we look at called the 5-year bar. And dependent on what that individual's immigration status is and when they entered the country, they could be subject to that 5-year bar, which means they have to have been in the country for a minimum of 5 years. Now, that's not all non-citizens, and there are definitely lots of special circumstances. I could probably talk about that for a good 2 hours for you with the non-citizens, but again, if there's anything in detail, you have specific scenarios, feel free to email me because I would be more than happy to look up, and get you more clarification because it really non-citizen status, we've really recently added a lot more to that non-citizen eligibility. And I know that definitely would fall into a lot of our homeless population.
Yeah, there's a lot of questions around that, but perhaps it's easier just for these nuance to say that it's nuance, unless you have an answer at the ready. It's when you've heard of refugee, if they are undocumented, then they may still be eligible.
That would depend on what type of refugee. I seriously would have to dig a little deeper. If you give me the certain, if you want to, if I can get like the certain circumstances, then I could probably give you a more cohesive answer to that question. Because again, there's so many different criteria that we have to look at when we're looking at refugees, like where they're coming from, when they came in, those sorts of things.
Someone else is saying if they don't have legal papers, but they have children that are US citizens.
Yeah, again, so many different policies that we'd have to get into detail because our policy recently, I mean, we have so much that was just added to accommodate for a lot of our refugees that are coming in who do not have homes. So again, many of these would have to be looked at on a case-by-case basis. So again, like these specific circumstances in the time slot that I have, I really would have to look in the policy for that. So again, if you would like to email me, I can get you a very thorough answer on those questions. Very thorough.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah, there's a lot in citizenship and non-citizen status. It talks about criminal history. Now, criminal history really isn't going to affect SNAP eligibility too much. When we're looking at criminal history and SNAP, typically the only time criminal history would make somebody not eligible for SNAP program would be is if they're a felon and they're being actively sought. Okay, so that means that there's a warrant out there for their arrest and law enforcement is intending to enforce that warrant within, I think it's like the next 10 days. So they're a felon and they're being actively sought, so they're on the run. That would be the pretty much the biggest circumstance that criminal history would impact SNAP eligibility. So it's not like, if somebody has a history of, has five misdemeanors on their record, that's not going to disqualify them from the SNAP program. We're looking more towards with SNAP eligibility. Are you on the run or are you incarcerated? Those are probably the two biggest instances that criminal history would impact, but we still evaluate it. Again, it's not going to have too much of an impact on SNAP benefits. The next, all household members must be listed on the application. Now, again, if you're working with somebody who's homeless, do we have to list everybody who's in the shelter? No. When we talk about households, we're talking about individuals who are eating together. So if you have somebody who is, eating on their own, they need to list themselves on the application. But if they are living in all of those individuals listed on the application. And we also look at resources and income, and they have to be under certain limits. The limits are established by the federal poverty income guidelines, which are updated every October. Uber, it's not let into determining if the income is under the limit because we do look at that gross income, as I already had said. However, there are multiple deductions that can be given on a case-by-case basis, and we also have standard deductions that are given to everybody. Okay. Resources, and this is like checking accounts, savings accounts, does somebody have a vehicle? That plays more into factor when you're looking at expedited SNAP. Most households who become or are eligible for SNAP program are not going to have a resource limit. That's not saying that they never have a resource limit. However, most that we see come in do not have a resource limit. As long as they stay under a certain percentage of the FPIG, which is 200% of the federal poverty income guidelines based on your however many individuals are applying. So that is just the basic criteria for SNAP. Those are what we call, that's kind of like what we look at for every application that comes in. This is more about eligibility. So if someone is determined eligible for SNAP benefits, they're going to get benefits back to the date of the application that it was submitted. So that's one of the good things. You may say, well, I applied and they have 30 days to process my application. So if I apply today and maybe I'm not eligible for that quick SNAP or that SNAP in a hurry for some reason or other, do I have to wait 30 days to get my benefits? Sometimes, depending if you need verification in, it may take a little longer. However, it's not like those benefits will begin the date that eligibility is determined. So if an application comes into a county assistance office today, right now at 2:17 p.m., and it's processed a week from now, that individual will get their SNAP benefits from today. Okay, so that's one thing that I really want to point out. We'll talk about the EBT card in just a few slides. And again, we already talked about the XSNAP, but if anybody had any more questions about XSNAP, I can absolutely address that as well. And I'm actually going to give you a little more detail on the XSNAP anyways. I kind of ad-libbed this earlier. I knew I was getting to it, but I didn't want to dissuade anybody's questions. These are the, okay, so when we look at expedited SNAP, we look at it in two different ways. Are you entitled and are you eligible? These are the three scenarios that we look at to see if somebody is entitled to SNAP benefits. So again, if we have a household, and when we talk about a household, we're talking about everyone that's eating together and buying their food together. If everyone in that household is either a migrant or seasonal farm worker, and they are what we call destitute, and they have less than $100 in liquid resources and nothing to live on, then that would make them entitled to expedited SNAP. Now, the term destitute, what does that actually mean? Second here, I want to give you the actual, because there's certain criteria for that. If how we determine if a migrant or seasonal farm worker household is destitute is we look at the income. If all of their income is from a terminated or ended source that's received before the application date, then that would be constitute destitution for a migrant or seasonal farm worker household. If they have no more than $25 expected to come in from a new source that is going to be received within 10 days of the application, that would also constitute destitution. It could also be a combination of the two. Okay. Now, I must caution that if they are meeting this criteria, everyone who is applying has to be a migrant or seasonal farm worker. So if you have a family that has, let's say, two parents and three children, and maybe two of the children are not migrant or seasonal farm workers, they would not meet this criteria. However, we would then look at the second criteria. Do they have liquid resources that are $100 or less? And when we look at all their countable monthly gross income, is it less than $150? Okay, so that would be the second criteria. These are our individuals who you can see are very ne in need of these benefits as quickly as possible, very limited income to even get food on their table. If neither of those are met, then we evaluate the household and look at their gross income and we add any liquid resources. So again, we consider liquid resources like cash on hand, obviously, bank accounts, certificates of deposit, which you don't see a lot, but you definitely do see. Probably the bank accounts and cash on hand would be what we'd look at. We'd combine that with their monthly gross income, all that they've already gotten and anything that they can expect to receive in that month. And if it's less than their monthly shelter expenses, then they would be entitled to expedited SNAP. Okay. So shelter expenses, I'm trying to see if I go and have a slide on this before I go into it. So give me just 1 second. We calculate shelter expenses based on what that individual pays for their rent or mortgage. And utility expenses, we look at the utilities that that individual or family pays, and we actually have standard utility allowances that we apply. So we take, if they are not homeless, we take whatever they're paying for their rent, mortgage, et cetera, plus whatever the appropriate standard utility allowance is, which is based on number one, the first factor we look at is, do they pay for heating or cooling? If they do not, then we look at what else they're paying for. Okay, so it's determined on that, and we add that to their rent or what they're paying for shelter. Okay, so if that income and those liquid resources are less than what they are going to have to pay out for shelter and utilities, then that would be entitled to expedited SNAP. Now, that's a lot. So does anybody have any questions?
Yeah, so there's quite a bit of questions, some going back from like reiterating different things that you've said. If it was crystal clear, I've tried to just answer that on my own to reiterate what you said. So going back to the very early on, the one we put on hold, can two individuals in the same household be receiving SNAP benefits? They are separate individuals. They're each receiving different amounts.
Yeah, absolutely. As long as they're not eating together. Yeah, if they're living in the same household, they have separate food budgets, they're purchasing and preparing on their own, then absolutely. We see that quite commonly that individuals, as long as they're not mandatory household members. And the only time somebody would be mandatory in somebody else's household would be if they're married, so spouses that are living in the same household, and also parents and children, or adults who exercise care and control over children. Okay. Other than that, if they're not eating together, it doesn't matter if they're living together. If they're not eating and purchasing and preparing together, they can absolutely get SNAP benefits on their own. Great question.
Yeah, and that's especially relevant, I know, as Pennsylvania is looking to increase home sharing options. I mean, we're going to be seeing that more and more. So, and I see a bunch of share counselors on today. So, this is
yeah, absolutely. So, yeah, get the word out there. If somebody is applying and they do live with multiple people, even having a note submitted with the application saying, you know, so and so lives with me, but we buy our food separately, we eat separately, we store it separately. We all have our section in the refrigerator. That's probably the quickest way to get that through there. So nobody questions, you know, that you're living with that person. Well, shouldn't you be eating with them? You know, so a statement is completely acceptable for those circumstances. Very good.
Great. If someone was working under the table and doesn't have pay stubs,
good question.
How does that affect things?
I like that. So if they're working under the table and they don't have pay stubs, we never limit verification of income to pay stubs. Never, never, never. There are many different ways we can verify income. So when we request verification of income, we just need something to show this is what your income is. In the instance of somebody who's working under the table, what I see and what is probably the best, you can certainly have just a handwritten note from that individual that is paying them. This is my name. This is my address. This is my phone number. I pay so and so this much to work this many hours. They are paid weekly, biweekly. And as long as we have the individual that is paying and a note from them, that is perfectly sufficient. So for example, my uncle was babysitting my son for a little bit when he was way younger, and he would take him on Fridays. He would watch him, and I would pay him. I think I paid him, like, he didn't even want to take money, but I still gave him $25 a day. So, you know, that was just something it was an under the table job, an example of that. If he were to apply for benefits, he could absolutely take a note from me saying, Heather Solly, my address, my phone number, I pay so-and-so this much money to watch my son one day a week, $25 a week. That is perfectly sufficient. Good question.
Great. Let's see. For individuals experiencing homelessness, get all these questions when we open it up to COCs. So for individuals experiencing homelessness without a PO box or residential address, do we direct them to ask CAO to send their benefits, packages, EBT, etc. to the CAO? So have any documents sent to CAO since they have no address, and then the individual picks up their documents after applying there, or is there another process? I know I've used like regular caseworkers before, like county addresses, but go ahead and chime in.
Yeah, that's definitely a very good question. There are multitudes of ways. They don't have to specifically, because a PO box, you have to pay for that. So we're not going to tell somebody they have to have a PO box to send their mail to in order to get benefits. So if they don't have something like that, they can absolutely, if they have a friend that allows them to get their mail or a relative, social service agencies, we can absolutely send notices to social service agencies. We always say that the CAO can absolutely be used for mailing purposes for notices as a last resort. Just need to request it and put it on there. And the biggest thing is, though, if somebody is getting their mail at the CAO, they have to make sure they consistently pick it up. Yeah, because that's one thing that, you know, after a certain time period, the clerical team does have a drawer for that. And, you know, they do keep that. And after a certain time period, if the mail goes on, you know, just sits there for a while, then there could be, you know, problems with the benefit at that point.
Great. And then regarding, so this goes back to the idea of two people like living together, but more for like income verification purposes. I have a client that's living with their parents, although they receive no income or assistance from them. Regarding SNAP, do you consider the entire household's income or just the one that would be using the benefit?
It would depend on that. If they're living with their parents, it would depend on their age. So our SNAP policy states that if a child is living with their parent and or parents and they are under the age of 22, then their parents' income, even if they're not eating with their parents' income
hey,
still has
Shella,
to be.
How are you? All right.
Hello? Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so if they are under the age of 22, then even if they're not eating with their parents, we still would have to get verification and consider their parents and the parents' income in determining eligibility. But if that individual is 22 and older, then absolutely they can get benefits just by themselves if they're living with their parents.
Okay. And then just a similar question came to clarify for the people that are doing home sharing. Mm-hmm. If there's two individuals living together, you don't have to, I hear this question a lot. You don't have to look at the whole income for everyone living in that household, right?
Nope. As long as they're not eating together, shared households, they get their own. Yep. They'll get their own deduction. Whatever they're paying towards their rent, they'll get that. We'll look at that. And the SUAs, it's based on what utilities are being paid. So we don't prorate those. So they'll get a full SUA for whenever we determine their benefits. Great question.
You doing construction, Priscilla?
I don't know who that is. I don't think anyone's allowed to unmute. So I'm really like intrigued right now. I will work on it as in between questions though. That's interesting. So now, before we had talked about like undocumented and all that, but what if someone has no proof of identity at all?
Okay. They can honestly, if we're looking at identity, we can absolutely take collateral contact. So if they have a friend or like there's somebody like their caseworker, somebody that works with them in the community, and they can attest to that individual's identity. Absolutely. So we're not going to deny somebody just because they can't get a photo ID. And there are many different sources that we can take out there, anything that, you know, reasonably proves that they are who they are. And I think probably the collateral contact is probably the easiest for a lot of individuals who can't, you know, don't have anything on paper out there that shows their name and photo on it.
Yeah. Now this is a very good question. What types of safeguards are in place regarding undocumented or I suppose even documented DV individuals? So domestic violence, often they're kept from being, becoming documented, by their abuser.
Yeah, we actually have, and that is a very good program that we actually have. It's the ACAP program. It's the Address Confidentiality Program. And we do not release any, a lot of individuals, and I'm sure you guys all know about those, that ACAP program where they have that card, we will absolutely only mail that information to what is stated on that card. And we will not document any information that is relevant in our case record to domestic violence. So we take many, many, many precautions to protect those who are, you know, victims of domestic violence. They can absolutely use the shelter. Again, we can also look into that address confidentiality program. If they're not already enrolled in that, all caseworkers should have information on that and be able to get that to them on how to get into that program as well.
Great. Someone, this is one of the ones I had answered in the chat, but it came up again. So can you explain the criminal record history again with eligibility?
Absolutely. For SNAP, it's not going to affect. There are the two biggest ways somebody's criminal history would impact eligibility for SNAP benefits would be number one, if they're incarcerated. If somebody's incarcerated, we cannot give them SNAP benefits because they already have their meals being provided to them. Okay, so if they are receiving SNAP and they become incarcerated and it's going to be something that's long term and they had benefits. Typically, those SNAP benefits would close. Now, the caseworker always verifies it's not going to be a day in and day out kind of thing. And obviously, on the flip side, if somebody is a felon, this only applies to felons, and they are on the run, and there is an active warrant out there that is intended to be enforced, like right now, okay? And we know that. We get verification of that. Then that could result in just that individual being ineligible until they get that taken care of. Okay. So if that active warrant is out there, maybe the sheriff is looking for them, ready to enforce it. They turn themselves in, they get it all taken care of. Then once that's taken care of, we can then review their eligibility. But that only affects the individual for whom has the criminal history. It again, if they have children, if they have a spouse, we could still look, they would still be eligible. So one person's criminal history won't affect the whole family.
Let's see, how is the pandemic SNAPs determined on what kids get them and what don't? Some schools are still giving free lunches to all.
Yeah, that's something that's outside of the realm of OIM, and I don't know if Stephanie can give some insight on that. I know that some schools are actually still giving the free SNAP lunches program. OIM had the P P I always mix up the letters on those, but those P E those P Pennsylvania those emergency SNAP benefits that were given to children. So they were like the little white cards that were to supplement the meals children weren't getting while they were in school, and the benefits actually went out during summer breaks and everything to cover lunches. And those were for children who were eligible for free or reduced lunches. Now there was a time period when every school, all the children got free lunches. Now I know the initiative statewide is for breakfast. Okay, so for breakfast, I think. The reason behind, and this is just an I think, this isn't I know on this. I think the reason behind some schools still offering the free lunches would be based on the availability of funding to that specific school. Because I know my son's school, like they still get the free breakfast, but the lunches now have to be paid for. Yeah, but I do know I have a class of trainees right now who are in school districts where their children are still getting free lunches, regardless of family income.
Okay. There is a question here about veterans and if there's different allowances for them. The way it's explained, what if someone is currently working and being paid on a weekly basis, but is also receiving their VA benefits on a monthly basis? Does the VA benefits get counted towards their total gross income? Most veterans are working and are not making enough to purchase food for their families, but get a reduced amount because they count both their working income and their VA monthly benefit.
Okay, so I think what we're asking here is will we look at like the partial veterans benefits or would we look at the full veterans benefits? Is that what we're asking there? That's what I'm thinking. I'm going to address it that way. We would just be looking at what they're getting from the VA benefits and we would combine that with the earned income.
Great, thank you. Yes, she said. So that was answered. Perfect. Thank you. Okay, we can move on.
Lady, I love that I'm getting so many great questions. Again, I already talked about this, but the applicants have to apply for SNAP in the county in which they reside. Our caseworkers are actually, it's our clerical team. I have to give them much, many kudos. But applications definitely, especially when we have counties that border each other. I know Somerset, I live in Cambria County, and I know Somerset and Cambria County, like I can throw a rock it from places in Cambria County and throw it right into Somerset County. And I know sometimes, you know, people will apply at the wrong CAO because of the closeness of the counties. Our clerical team is really good at, as long as the information is on there, getting those applications to the appropriate county. Also, we allow, sometimes people are unable to apply for themselves. We can absolutely have, they can absolutely designate another person to act as something called an authorized representative. And that could be any of you working with, you know, individuals out in the community. If you have a client who, you know, has a severe disability, they can't complete their application on their own, they could designate, you know, an author, you as an authorized representative, and you could not only apply on their behalf, but you could actually get a card and use those benefits on their behalf. I've seen this in my county specifically. We had, I don't know if it still exists or if it's, or if they now have a food program, but we had a drug and alcohol facility that did not provide meals. So when the individuals would go in that rehabilitation facility, they would come in with one of the representatives from there, and they would be their authorized representative, and they would both have access to those SNAP benefits. Again, we need that designated in writing, but essentially that can be anybody. It can be a friend, a relative, social service agency. So that is something that is really good out there, especially for individuals who are disabled or maybe have barriers. So that's one thing that's out there. And again, once that application is submitted, 30 days. 30 days from the date that we get it in the office, it has to be processed. The more you get in with the application, the biggest thing is when you're applying, make sure you have some sort of ID. If you've had benefits in the past, your ID is most likely already verified. However, if you have any income, just send in something that proves that income. That's going to quicken the process of getting SNAP benefits. And the next slide is, this is just kind of what I was just saying leads into that. We want to make this process, we want our Pennsylvanians to get these benefits as quickly and seamlessly as possible. We're not trying to make the application process difficult, even though sometimes it can be difficult and daunting to individuals who do apply. So I'm just going to offer, and absolutely, these are some of the greatest tips that can speed up the process. We get assigned, if helping a customer with an application, remind that customer, okay, who you're working with. In order for us to process an application, we need three things: a name, an address, and a signature. So if that application comes in signed, that's going to hold up the process. So having a signed application is crucial. That could actually delay even expedited SNAP, not having that signature. Now, income, again, we do have the capability of verifying some income. We can get information from different online sources, but there are only certain ones, so we can't verify everything. So my best advice would be, provide, if you have income, provide verification when you are applying, okay? Because if it's right there, not only can we evaluate you for expedited SNAP, but we also can evaluate you for the ongoing benefits, which are going to be the monthly benefits that you get on the EBT card. Now, again, I already spoke to the verification. Can we only accept pay stubs? No. That's the most common that people give us and think of, but I've seen employer letters. I've actually talked to people on the phone and gotten collateral contact for verification. People who are self-employed can use their 1040s. Again, we talked about the odd jobs are under the table, a letter from the individual for whom they're working. The only stipulation, again, just like I said before, is we need the rate of the pay. So if they're paying them hourly, give me that. If they're paying them on a daily rate, give me that. The number of hours worked, the gross wages, just like we said before, and proof of the past 30 days income. So a letter would suffice for that, because we can, you know, just spell that out in the letter. And even as I just said, this can also be verified through collateral contact. So I'm going to go into talking about the EBT card if nobody has any other questions. This also states identification and social security number. We do not need individuals. We do not need individual social security cards. We just need the number, okay? And we talked about residency. Any questions?
So there's the one for the emergency shelter allowance, so that'll wait. Can you please explain the reconsideration process that customer service advises people? They can request their application be reconsidered if they are late getting requested information returned.
Well, yeah, absolutely. So if they're late, they go past that 30 days. Caseworkers, we have to, as caseworkers, we have to reject that on day 30. Consideration. That's the recording again. They can do a reconsideration for those benefits, and it would go off that date of application still. And there are many times individuals can claim good cause. So again, all of our notices that go out, you can, they have the verbiage on how you can appeal, how you can contact the supervisor you should contact, and how to get a re how, what the right reconsideration process is. But simply contacting your caseworker, getting that verification in is going to be your best method of getting that application reconsidered. You don't have to completely reapply if you can't meet that 30-day deadline for some reason.
Great, thanks. I have a reminder from someone else from OIM about just to remind everyone that if they have several people applying at, in one household, all have to be listed on the application. So just sending that reminder out. Let's see, this question is on hold. That question, that's an answer. You're going to go into EBT, so I'm going to wait for that one. Would an ID from another country work?
Yeah, I've seen people use high school IDs. I've seen people use their prison IDs. I've seen like community college IDs. So we really don't limit any kind of verification on identification.
Great. When determining eligibility for benefits and proof of income, what is the process when it CV client applies, does their income have to be assessed based on the person that they are trying to get away from? And that goes back to your idea of who is eating with them, right?
Yeah. Oh, I like that. Okay. So, the best example where I think we're going with this is, let's say we have spouses that are open in SNAP benefits, and I talk about this when I do an introduction to SNAP benefits to all new caseworkers. So, let's say we have a couple spouses living together, and we have a perpetrator, and we have the other individual who's going to a sh maybe a shelter for battered individuals to escape that domestic violence. Maybe they already are open on SNAP benefits with that individual who is the perpetrator of the domestic violence. We do have provisions out there to actually get that victim of domestic violence, and there can be circumstances when they actually are able to be issued additional SNAP benefits if they are a victim of domestic violence and they are in a shelter for battered individuals. So I think that kind of hits that topic.
Great.
This is our old EBT card. Now, this is a legacy one. I'm sure that it's still out there for some individuals. The current EBT card you're going to see on the next slide, it's much more aesthetically pleasing. But these slides just talk about what can SNAP benefits be used for, because you preface the SNAP program to get that, it's for food. But what kind of food? Like a lot of people ask questions, can I get soda? It's supposed to be healthy food. Well, you anything that's consumable, yeah, you can get soda, you can get canned. Now it says up here, it just kind of tells you the process of like how an EBT card works. It works exactly as a debit card works. So an individual will get their EBT card access to them. They use that at a point of sale system in any store or authorized retailer that accepts SNAP benefits, and they have to enter their PIN just like they would with a debit card, and that will access their SNAP benefits to pay for their food items only. We load those SNAP benefits automatically on the EBT card once a month. Okay, so it's dependent on the county in which that individual resides. There are different dates that are that the SNAP benefits are dispersed. So if somebody is getting SNAP benefits, they would want to reach out to their specific caseworker if they're unsure on the day of the month that they're going to get their benefits. It will be the same. I don't want to say date, but we use benefit issue and states that are typically based on the business day. So you'll see it around the same time each month, but it's always at the beginning of the month. Okay. SNAP, actually, in addition to being used at groceries and any authorized stores or retailers, like you probably see that Dollar General accepts SNAP and EBT cards. It can also be used at public and private nonprofit organizations that feed homeless individuals. And that can absolutely be a soup kitchen if they have a charge, halfway house, supervised shelters, similar organizations with temporary house people. FNS does have a restaurant program that individuals can use EBT or SNAP benefits in restaurants. However, right now, Pennsylvania, there actually is the restaurants that have to actually apply and get a contract to be part of this program. And Pennsylvania has not had any restaurants who've opted into this program and actually applied at this point. So that's not something that's available. And that is leads me into benefit allotments. This is the new and current SNAP EBT card. Again, it works the exact same magnetic stripe. There's a PIN, four digits, just like a debit card. This just goes into what can those benefits be used for. So whenever we determine SNAP benefits, the allotments are based on the number of households that are applying. So that would be the individuals that are actually eating together and receiving their benefits all as one. For example, if I am looking at a household size of three people, come October 1st, the maximum SNAP benefit for a household size of three people would be $766. Okay. So that's kind of what we're looking at. Now that is maximum if that household comes to have absolutely no net income after all of the deductions are applied. Okay. Benefits, those SNAP benefits can be used to buy any fruits or vegetables, meat, poultry, fish, dairy products like cheese, yogurt, bread, cereals, any kind of snack food, any kind of drinks out there, juices, sodas, as long as it's not alcoholic. You can't buy any alcohol with SNAP benefits. And one of the things that people don't actually realize is that seeds and plants can actually be used. So if it's summertime and, you know, your local grocery store is selling those tomato plants that somebody wants to plant their own garden, buying a tomato plant may be something that is going to produce multiple feeding, you know, meals rather than just buying one tomato at the store. So those seeds and plants that produce food for the household to eat are also an option out there. Okay. Let's see if there's anything I'm missing. I think I'm missing anything else. Individuals cannot, I don't want to go into the cannots, but you kind of have to. Foods that are purchased hot at the point of sale, so like a sheet's hot steak stuff, or a chicken at Walmart, like a rotisserie chicken at Walmart that comes right off the rotisserie, that would be something that wouldn't be able to be purchased with SNAP benefits. However, if it's cold and it's in the case, like at Walmart, they have those cold subs that are already pre-prepared, that would be something that they could purchase with SNAP benefits. Any questions on what SNAP can be used for? If not, I can talk a little bit about the employment and training program as well.
Sorry, I was muted. The only question here that's remaining about SNAP is if someone is eligible for SNAP, does those school PEBT from the school program SNAP benefits go onto someone's regular EBT card instead of the special card that was given to everyone in the district?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So if they're already receiving SNAP benefits, they should go on just the regular EBT card. If they're already receiving SNAP, that would be an additional. Yeah. And the individuals who do not receive any SNAP, they get the white card. They get the white cards. Good question.
And I've heard individuals experiencing homelessness can use SNAP benefits at fast food places. Is this true?
Not in Pennsylvania currently, but that is something, you know, that it is allowable per FNS. But the restaurant has to actually there's an application process. So the restaurant has to actually meet certain criteria and they have to apply for it. Yeah, unfortunately not in Pennsylvania, but hopefully that's something that fast food restaurants and other restaurants in the future could look to in PA.
Okay, let's see, there is another, I'll hold the other question till the end. In the interest of time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, SNAP employment and training program. Just a little bit on the optional employment and training program. It's not something that is mandatory for SNAP recipients. However, it is a very good program that not a lot of people are aware that's out there. So if you have individuals who maybe want to go back to school, but there are like multiple barriers, like they don't have transportation. They don't have the money to even pay the application fee. We have an employment and training program that's out there for SNAP recipients. It's actually called the SNAP Keys program, and it works with community colleges across Pennsylvania. So a lot of times individuals who are eligible for SNAP can also ask about the employment and training programs that are available in their area, because if they want to further their education so they can get a better job, those are supports that their caseworkers can direct them to. Yeah, we have multiple programs that are out there. Sometimes I've seen people do like job searches and things of the sort, but there's definitely employment and training programs that are out there and available. Not mandatory, but if it's something that would be helpful to somebody with whom you're working, ask. Doesn't hurt to ask, because that is out there and caseworkers should be giving information and they should get information, but not everybody looks at all the paperwork that we get when we see those notices come out. I want to make sure I hit healthcare coverage, because that is a big thing, unless we have any other questions on the SNAP program. Awesome. So healthcare coverage, again, you can apply just like I told you for SNAP benefits. How do we apply for healthcare coverage? We're going to make every effort when those applications come in, whether they're Compass or paper applications, we're going to make every effort as caseworkers to process that application with information provided by the applicant when that application is submitted, or any other electronic sources that we have out there. Okay, so we do have a multitude of agencies that we work with, and we're able to verify income, like social security income, child support, even unemployment compensation, and some of wages. So if somebody is just applying for medical assistance, that caseworker, it is our policy that we are to be reviewing that application to try to get it processed without having to make any contact with that customer, so we can get it opened as seamlessly and as quickly as possible. Okay, but who can apply? Individuals don't, it's not just individuals that can apply for themselves for medical assistance. We can absolutely and see a lot of medical providers that actually apply for medical assistance on behalf of individuals. And this encompasses that representative of a hospital or institution. You may see this, especially, you know, with like a homeless population. I do know in my area, mental health facilities, unfortunately, would tend to fill up during the colder seasons of the year, just so because we don't have a lot of shelters in the area in which I live. And the mental health facilities would fill up would fill up pretty quickly in the colder months of the year. So a lot of times representatives from those mental health facilities could actually apply for medical assistance on behalf of those individuals to get those services covered. We can have child welfare agencies for foster children applying for medical benefits. And honestly, just like SNAP program, we can have those authorized representatives, okay, if somebody can't apply on their own.
The only time we're going to request verification, we're going to do make every single attempt to process a medical assistance application. If we are unable to verify information provided by the applicant, or if what they told us is conflicting with maybe something that is on their application, or something that they give us, or maybe they previously had benefits and it contradicts it, then at that point we would request additional verification from the customer. With that, before I field any questions, I just want to go over what's required to apply for healthcare coverage. Now, as you can see, I'm saying healthcare coverage because we not only manage medical assistance now, but again, as I mentioned at the beginning of my presentation, we also have taken on the processing of CHIP applications as well. So, what's required to apply for healthcare coverage? We always need that proof of identity, income. If somebody, one of the good things about a medical assistance program, and this is medical assistance only, medical assistance can pay for unpaid medical expenses if they are in the what we call the retro period, and that would be 3 months prior to the date that individual applied for medical assistance. Now we do have to verify that. So that's why the medical expense for which is being payment is being requested, that has to be submitted if they're requesting for us to pay a previous bill. The bill has to remain unpaid too. If they have existing medical coverage, so if we're looking at our Medicare recipients who are looking for that Part B, what we call buy-in, we need verification of their existing medical coverage. So we need a copy of the Medicare card. And if there is a contradictory statement or something that we feel is questionable, then they may be requested to provide proof of just proving that a statement that is true. And there are certain things that we never request verification on, and that would be somebody's claim of pregnancy. For medical assistance residency, we take the statement. Who lives with them or with whom they live? If there's a caretaker or relative, or if somebody is claiming American Indian or Alaska Native status. So those are always statement only. Okay. And one of the big things is there are a lot higher income limits for pregnant women. So again, we can take that statement. They do not need to send in verification, and that will give a much higher income limit for an individual who is pregnant. Any questions before I talk about what medical assistance pays for?
Someone's asking if the program will pay for tuition.
For tuition, for are you talking about the SNAP employment training?
Yeah, the question came through about 4 minutes ago,
Oh,
so
okay, that's what I'm assuming. We don't pay for tuition. However, sometimes if somebody is going to college and they're in like a SNAP PEAS program with a community college, we can help with supporting them to go to that college. So if they need help with maybe books or tools or things like that, we have things called special allowances, and it's dependent on the program they're in. If it's an approved activity, and again, this would be dependent on that individual circumstance and whether with SNAP, there's availability for like supplies and books and things of sort. When we get into cash, there's a lot more availability for special allowances or supports to get that individual, but we do not pay for tuition. That's one thing that we would advise them to get on and not fill out a FAFSA.
okay, great. So I just want to acknowledge that it's three, and I know some of you were expecting to end at this time. So we do have, this is all recorded, and you will have the slides. So you will have access to anything that you need to hop off for. We had tons of questions, which is great. But I do want to honor your time too, but we will keep going and look out for the link if it's something that you need to hop off from.
Apologize, and I'll try to get through the rest of this quicker here. I think all the questions at the beginning there kind of threw us off a little bit. Medical assistance program, we pay for healthcare services for eligible individuals. Typically DHS, and this is Medicaid, medical assistance is not going to pay for new and expensive medicine or any kind of experimental treatments out there. But not only does medical assistance offer medical coverage, but it's also dental and vision to individuals who are eligible based on meeting non-financial resource and income eligibility criteria. Now, we don't make payments to those individuals. We make direct payments to the health professionals and vendors like the hospitals and pharmacies. Also, prescription coverage comes with that. We can also, like I said, pay for unpaid medical expenses that a household may have had from the previous 3 months. These are just the different types of medical assistance programs we have. Healthy Horizons is a medical assistance program that is specifically for elderly and disabled individuals. And this type of medical assistance, now all of these provide the exact same coverage, okay? It's just dependent on what program that individual is in, is dependent on what deductions are applied, and just the basically the federal reimbursement, the category that is on our end. So it doesn't make any difference in the coverage. But Healthy Horizons is a medical assistance category that's available for elderly and disabled individuals. And this is where we had that question, what about the Medicare? Can we buy in or pay those Medicare premiums? This Healthy Horizons Medical not only provides medical assistance, but those who have Medicare, this can also pick up the Medicare Part B premiums. And sometimes maybe individuals would not be eligible for medical assistance, but we could just pick up the Medicare premium, okay, depending on the income and resources. We also have medical assistance that came about because of the Affordable Care Act, and that's what we call MAGI Medical. It just simply stands for Modified Adjusted Gross Income. And this is a term I'm sure many of you have heard of or, you know, seen on your tax return. So essentially, the Affordable Care Act follows federal tax rules. So this actually opened up medical coverage for adults, families, children, and pregnant women to have more income and access medical assistance benefits. Deductions are different when we're looking at medical assistance for the elderly and disabled. Unearned deductions, now that would be like your unemployment compensation, your Social Security benefits, things of that sort. There aren't as many deductions for those as opposed to individuals who are elderly or disabled and working. So there's many deductions that can be applied if we have individuals who are elderly and disabled and they're working, earning income. There are a lot more deductions that can be taken off of for this Healthy Horizons Medical. Now, the MAGI or the Affordable Care Act-based medical assistance, that, again, is going to be based on federal tax rules, essentially. That covers our adult, our 0 through 64, individuals 0 through 64, so families, children, pregnant women, follows tax rules. So the deductions are going to come from federal tax rules. So tax deductions is based on tax filing status. So if someone has tax deductions, then they would get deductions off their gross income for this type of medical. Sometimes people don't qualify because they're way over income, but they have a large hospital bill. We have two different types of medical assistance known as non-money payment and medically need only. Those are just what we call them on a DHS basis. At one point, these two types of medical offer different services. However, now the only difference between the two is the one has a monthly income limit and the other has a 6 month income limit. These types of medical allow for individuals who have unpaid medical bills. They can either with this program get that medical bill partially paid, or with this program use those unpaid medical bills to make them eligible moving forward. So that's a kind of cool option for individuals who may be way over income. MOD's a good medical assistance program for workers with disabilities, very high income limits. And because it's working for the individual who's disabled and working, they actually, off of their gross income, get it cut in half when it comes to the deductions for MOD. There can be and is usually a premium associated with medical assistance for workers with disabilities. Again, the premium usually is smaller, way smaller than what an individual would have to pay if they were to go out into the marketplace. So this is a great, fantastic program, the MOD program that is out there. We also have medical assistance for children with disabilities, and this is our loophole. It's known as loophole, but also PH95 medical assistance. And this is actually for permanently disabled children. And we, if they do not qualify for any other medical assistance program, but they are disabled, we verify their parents' income, but we disregard their income and only look at that income of the child. Okay, which essentially we're usually looking at a zero income, which gets them eligible. We also offer long-term care and home and community-based services and medical coverage for foster care. Alrighty, do you want me to continue, Helen?
Yeah, go ahead. I'm going to hold questions until the end, as long as your time allows.
Okay, I'm good. I hate that I'm taking more time than I was allotted there. Okay, so medical assistance, we're providing mental health, drug, and like this is one of the biggest things. Not only do we provide through our medical assistance healthcare coverage, dental, and vision, it also covers mental health, drug and alcohol, okay? And there's the vision and dental, in addition to that physical health. So if somebody needs to go inpatient, drug and alcohol services, medical assistance will pay for that. Also the outpatient. Any kind of inpatient and outpatient hospital services, psychiatrics, any kind of services, including those inpatient hospitalizations, prescription drug coverage, PCP, crisis intervention. And another thing that people don't think of is we actually have a medical transportation program. Okay, so there's actually medical transportation that comes right alongside to get individuals who need assistance getting to their appointments.
Someone is asking, what if a client has a medication that cannot be substituted for and is life-sustaining?
Okay. And will be covered?
Okay. And what do you recommend if someone is applying for MOD but has too much money in their bank account? I know if applicants have too much in resources and may not qualify.
Yeah, it's a $10,000 limit for the resources. So if they have too much in their bank account, honestly, if they have a medical expense, to pay that on a medical expense would be good. One of the things that we don't look at, and this is probably the best recommendation, it can be placed into an irrevocable burial reserve, and we would exclude that. So that's one thing, an irrevocable burial reserve, we wouldn't count that for a moment. Yeah. Unfortunately, that resource limit does push a lot of people out there. We do actually have programs that are newer with the MOD program. So individuals who have already been open a MOD, it expands the resource limits for people who go who start making more money. Okay. But again, those are only for individuals who are previously opened in the MOD program, already open, and they're going over resource or income limit.
Great. Thanks, Heather.
You're welcome. Chip? Again, we just determine eligibility for CHIP. DHS actually oversees CHIP. In April of this year, we actually began handling all the CHIP applications, renewals, the case updates, and eligibility questions for CHIP families. Now, the big question is, well, okay, I'm applying for medical assistance. How do I, if my child doesn't qualify for medical assistance, how do I know if they're going to qualify for CHIP? Okay. Now, regardless of family size and income, any child or teen can be eligible if they are under 19, a U.S. citizen, a U.S. national, or they're lawfully present, a resident of PA. And the biggest thing is they cannot hold insurance that needs minimal essential coverage. Okay. And they cannot be eligible for medical assistance. So what that means is once we get an application for medical assistance, if that child is over the income limits for every single medical assistance program that we offer, then we will then evaluate them in CHIP. Okay, we will evaluate and get them open in the CHIP program. And then CHIP will take over at that point. Okay, we just to determine the eligibility. CHIP is very similar to medical assistance as far as coverage. These are just some of the things that CHIP does cover. Okay, so the children are your children. children are still receiving high quality, that comprehensive insurance. It still covers the dental, the vision, the mental health, okay, substance abuse treatment, home health, rehabilitation, even autism spectrum disorder and related services. So it's paying for a lot of the same things. The biggest thing with CHIP is they are individual children who are eligible for CHIP will be enrolled in something called an MCO, managed care organization, which they select. And it will be dependent on the managed care organization that they pick as to what the coverage is. There are some things that are mandated, but then again, different managed care organizations pay for different things. CHIP can and is absolutely free to some people, to some families, to many families that have a higher income that makes that, but they're still over the income limits for medical assistance. And the free CHIP is going to have no monthly premium, no co-pays, no deductibles, just like medical assistance. But it's CHIP coverage, okay? So it's medical coverage. This is healthcare coverage. This is no longer medical assistance. If they reach a certain income threshold, then we also have a low-cost CHIP program in which we evaluate children for. And there are monthly premiums that range from $53 to $86 for the low-cost CHIP. And that, again, is dependent on the managed care organization or company that the individual picks, okay? So there's a whole big list of the managed care organizations that are available in each county. And the ones that cover more typically are going to be are going to have the higher monthly premiums. Premiums do need to be paid in order for this CHIP to begin. And the low-cost CHIP does have co-pays, and those range from $5 to $25, depending on the services. There is full-cost CHIP, and this is for all children. There is no income limit for full-cost CHIP. Okay, so if their income exceeds a certain threshold, they can absolutely still get full-cost CHIP. And those monthly premiums can range anywhere from $160 to $325. And then just like many of our medical coverages, it's $15 to $50 is what our co-pays range from, depending on what type of service. And again, the premiums are going to be based on a number of factors. We're looking at income, that plan selection, and what's available in that county. And this is just an example I thought I'd throw out there. Just to kind of give you an idea of what the income limits are. This would be a four-person family, okay? So if we were looking at free CHIP, if their income lies between $47,000 and $62,400 annually, they could be eligible for the free CHIP. Low cost would be a little higher. So if we get that 62.4 up to 78.6, that's that low cost. And then the highest income limit we see here, these are the low cost CHIP ones. And then if we go over that, then that would be the full cost CHIP. Okay. So these would just be the low cost and the free CHIP. It just gives you kind of the range. So if you are getting somebody that's exceeding a family of four, $94,200 annually, then it would have to be looked at for that full cost CHIP. I do have a whole selection on cash too, if nobody has any questions on medical assistance.
If a child is under the age of 19 and can receive medical insurance through a parent's employer, are they still eligible?
For CHIP?
Mm-hmm.
Not for CHIP. Medical assistance, yes, but not for CHIP. So yeah, if there is any kind of medical assistance, do you mean if there's any kind of medical assistance, I'm sorry, medical coverage already present, if they have something that does meet minimum essential coverage, then we cannot open a CHIP budget. It's only for uninsured children.
Okay. And what about if they have the option to go into the parents' insurance, if that's what they were getting at?
Oh, that's what they're getting at. Oh, if they have the option. Okay. If they don't, well, we look to see if they have it. Okay, so if they wouldn't be open in it, then they could perhaps be looked at for the CHIP program.
Okay. And then with the different amounts per chip, does the monthly premium cover all of the children, or do you pay the total amount for how many children you have?
It would be based per child. That would be individual when I gave you the example premiums. Yep.
Okay, and does CHIP provide any benefits for parents or guardians who are full or part-time caregivers for their children?
It does not. Unfortunately, it's only for that they have to be under age 19. Yeah.
Okay. I see that Stephanie has to hop off shortly. So, Stephanie, I just want to ask you if there's anything that you would like to add while you're still here with us.
So I'll just briefly note, I want to thank everyone. I think it's really clear that this robust participation from a webinar shows that this information is really desperately needed. And thanks for keeping Heather and everyone on our toes. Hopefully it's been a lot of useful information, but I think it's also clear to us that maybe we can do these a little more frequently. I think there's a lot of benefit and folks are really learning. So thank you all. Thank you for all that you do to support our Pennsylvania neighbors and friends and communities. We appreciate you so much. And for other follow-up needs, we'll try to follow up with Helen and others afterwards to make sure information gets back to you. But thanks again, and thank you, Heather, and all for joining.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, thank you. And if it's okay, like if Heather still has time, I'll let her finish the information that she'd like to present.
Yeah, good. I can get through it. Yeah.
Okay,
Yeah,
great.
best to stay with you. Okay, cash assistance. Cash assistance is also known as our TANF program. It's actually a program that provides money, not only money, okay? It's actually encompasses all sorts of supportive services. And what we're trying to do with the cash assistance program or TANF program is to promote an individual's self-respect to help them get rehabilitation and financial independence. So cash assistance is designed with many different purposes, and it can be one or all of these that you see on this slide. We can have adults who come in who are just really struggling to find a job. We can have an individual who maybe has a master's degree and they cannot find work. They are completely out of work. We can quickly engage that adult in work or work activities. And it doesn't have to be even somebody with a degree. It could be somebody with a resume that has tons of job experience. They just can't find something that is sustainable to support their families. Sometimes cash can be used to divert the need for families to be on long-term cash assistance. For example, maybe somebody's employer is going to have like a 2-month layoff where they're just going to shut down for some reason, and there will be no income coming in to that household at all. We have a program that is a cash assistance program that diverts that family's need to go on long-term cash assistance by giving them a lump sum to cover bills. We can also help with cash assistance to help working families. So maybe they're working, but they're not making enough money with their, they can only get some part-time minimum wage of employment. They're not making enough money to be able to support their families. We can assist those working families receiving TANF to support their employment. And we also want to help Pennsylvania families reach the highest level of work participation possible. So we do that through a variety of employment and training programs. And this kind of piggybacks at the optional SNAP employment and training program. Not that it's the same thing, in that it does the SNAP employment training program, is this builds upon that, I guess I would say. Any individual who would be eligible for cash assistance automatically is eligible for medical assistance, and they will get an Access Medical card. It's our recommendation, best practice, to request both cash and medical when completing an application. But again, if somebody just inadvertently checks cash, it will automatically be reviewed for medical unless that individual asks that they not be reviewed for medical, which I don't think I've ever seen, but. Everyone out there has the right to apply for cash assistance, and by doing so, they're going to get an application individual. So again, just like our other benefits, they can apply on their own or on behalf of somebody else, like the authorized representative. At one point, cash assistance had to be all face-to-face. Now, because of COVID and the offices closing, the county assistant's office is closing, this policy was actually altered a bit. So now individuals who apply for cash assistance are actually scheduled for a telephone interview. Now they can request an in-person interview, but by default, caseworkers will schedule them for a telephone interview. Now, unlike the medical and SNAP programs, cash assistant has to have that interview completed, okay, in order to be eligible for benefits. It is scheduled as quickly as possible. It has to be scheduled within 13 days of that date that application was turned into the office. Okay, so we want to try to get individuals who are truly needy in and open in benefits as quickly as possible. It's typically you see this available to families with children, also pregnant single women, but we also, like I mentioned earlier, have a refugee cash assistance program as well that mirrors the cash assistance TANF program. Just like our other programs, we process applications within 30 days, and there are additional supportive services in addition to the cash benefits that are paid out to any kind of cash recipient. So I will give that in more detail in a few slides here. There are different requirements for cash assistance, actually more requirements for cash assistance than there are for any other program that we do offer out there. So not only do they have to give us that information about their age, their residence, their employment, their income, resources, any kind of legally responsible relatives out there, verification. We also have additional requirements that have to be met in order for a person to be eligible for cash. Unless there's a good reason for doing so, like domestic violence, they have to cooperate in obtaining court-ordered support and establishing paternity if there is a parent that is not in the household. Okay, so if we have one parent and the other parent is absent, that is an additional requirement, and it has to be done through DRS, through a court order. Any potential income that is out there. So if somebody is disabled, and definitely would be eligible for Social Security benefits, it is a condition of eligibility that they apply for that potential income because it decreases the need for assistance. Not only does it decrease the need for assistance, but if an individual, when compared to Social Security benefits, even the SSI benefits, they're much more than what a TANF benefit's going to be. Okay, so it's hand in hand, not only a conditional eligibility, but it definitely is beneficial to the customer as well. For the most part, it is a requirement to participate in employment training activities unless that individual needs an exemption because they're disabled, or there are a couple other different exemptions out there as well. They can also establish good cause for just some different reasons that are evaluated on a case-by-case basis. That maybe there's some reason that they cannot engage in employment or some kind of training activity at that time. There is a document called an Agreement of Mutual Responsibility, which I love that, and we call that the AMR and DHS. And that actually is a mutual document that the caseworker and the individual for whom is going to receive those benefits develop together. It's a plan of action to get that person off assistance, essentially what it means. And does that mean off assistance within 3 months? Not necessarily. It could be baby steps. But again, that agreement of mutual responsibility drives the cash assistance program because we do not want our cash assistance clients to be reliant on the small amount of cash that that pays when we could absolutely support and have the whole component of the employment and training to help them alleviate any barriers that are keeping them from being employed, okay, which can be a number of things. Just like SNAP, cash gets loaded on the EBT card. Not only can individuals use it as point of sale purchases, and this would be for non-food items. They can use their cash for anything except for at liquor stores, casinos, or places for adult entertainment. That cash is loaded directly onto the EBT card, but that's those monthly payments are split up into two. So it's paid two times a month. And not only can it be used in a store, but individuals who receive cash assistance can absolutely use an ATM and pull that cash off that card just as they would in a debit or a debit card. Okay. So that is a benefit to that as well. We like to keep lists at the CAOs to let our cash recipients know about the no surcharge ATMs, because if there is a surcharge on that ATM machine, it will charge the it will take that off the cash benefit as well. So that's a good thing to know. Now, there are so many different programs and services that we offer to our individuals or enroll our individuals who are receiving TANF. We have a program that we work with called the EARN program. That's the Employment Advancement and Retention Network. We have a Work Ready program. We have a KEYS program that is with the Pennsylvania's Community College. We have a LEFT program, which actually works with the high schools, that works with pregnant or parenting teens. We can help individuals with job search activities, employment, and career preparation. There are refugee employment providers out there that we work with. And also for individuals with drug and alcohol issues, we can absolutely use their rehabilitative services as their employment and training activities. So if they are in any of these activities, we can also provide those additional special allowances for financial support. So they don't have a car, we can get them a bus pass. Maybe they don't have a bus line in their area, we can help them pay for a cab or an Uber or a Lyft. Clothing is out there. We do work with Pennsylvania Workwear to try to help any clothing needs. But again, if it's something that PA Workwear could not provide, we can help with that as well. TANF clients can get help to purchase a vehicle, which is a great, great program out there. However, it's only $1,500 and it's only once in a lifetime, and they cannot have another vehicle, okay? And they have to have a need for that vehicle to accept employment. We can also help with work, education, and training expenses. Like I said before, you know, like books, maybe fees, equipment, materials, although we cannot help people pay their tuition. And one of the biggest benefits of receiving cash assistance are getting childcare, free childcare through the Early Learning Resource Center. Many people are familiar with this and know that it can and does have a long waiting list. But when somebody's receiving TANF cash assistance, they're bumped to the top of the list, so they automatically get it. So it's really cool. Here's the ESA information. I know everybody wanted this, and I had it at the end. I should have put it at the beginning. Emergency shelter allowances are granted once during it's only granted once during a 12 consecutive time period. Okay, so. What happens is if somebody is in danger of being evicted or foreclosed upon, we can help to prevent that, okay? We can also issue emergency shelter allowances for individuals who do not have permanent housing, obtain that permanent housing. And we also have emergency shelter allowances to get temporary help individuals with temporary shelter. Okay, now again, this benefit is only available to an individual once in a 12-month time period. So if I get an ESA this month, an emergency shelter allowance right now on the 25th, I am not eligible for another one until the 25th of September of next year. There are different limits dependent on the circumstance. So if somebody has, they actually have to have an eviction notice or a foreclosure notice. We can give up to $400 to prevent that eviction. Now, if it exceeds that $400, that individual has to give us verification that they can cover the additional. And then we have to talk with the landlord in order to make sure that that eviction will be stopped with us issuing that check to that landlord. That is for families, for an individual who's under 21 or for families with children under 21. If there's nobody under 21, then it's $300. Permanent living quarters is a little bit less. When we have the children, it's $300. Okay, so if it's under an individual under 21, or if it's a family with a child under age 21, we can do up to $300. Again, this could be maybe you need a $200 security deposit. That $300 would cover it, so we could issue $200 for that security deposit. Again, just like the eviction, if it's over, we would need verification or a payment of anything in excess in order to get or secure those permanent living quarters. And again, it's less than for individuals over 21 and if there's no children. Now, temporary shelter is $100 maximum. You can only get one of these in these two in that time frame. However, if somebody comes in and it comes in off the street and they need that night right now to provide temporary shelter, we can give them up to $100, maybe put them up in a hotel for the night. Now, if they or for a few nights, if they get this temporary shelter grant, they can also get the permanent living quarters in that 12-month time period. That's the only exception. This is Social Security. This just talks about SSI and how we do not administer it, but we absolutely do administer the medical assistance to which all SSI recipients are entitled. And then we also give a supplemental payment. And these are the current payments that are in effect right now from that we issue those on the EBT card. These are just some tips, and I'm going to kind of end with that because I know we're over time. But again, these are just tips that definitely are good that we've gone over the whole way through that I've been speaking right now. So again, since this is going out, absolutely all those tips will be on there for everybody to look at. But I guess that's about it. That's all I have.
Oh, thank you, Heather. We do have a couple of questions that I'll circle back to now. Okay. So, and it's hard to know if some of these came in before you answered something or if someone was asking you to clarify what you already said, but can anyone with a disability apply for MOD?
Okay, so it has to be something that's medically substantiated. We can open MOD presumptively. So if they get information from their doctor, like let's say they have pulmonary artery disease, okay? They're not receiving Social Security or anything like that at the time, but they can get information from their doctor. They can absolutely, and they're working, they can apply for that and they can be open presumptively. And what happens is we have a medical review team who will review all that medical documentation, and they use the same process that Social Security uses to verify and confirm that, to certify that they are permanently disabled. So they have to be permanently disabled, but not necessarily verified by Social Security, because Social Security does look at that SGA, or that substantial gainful income. So there's an income threshold there. And many people who are working with disabilities and need MOD have income that is way too high to even qualify for those Social Security benefits.
Great, thank you. Is there still Pathways program for job training? If so, can you explain how it works?
Pathways program.
Pathways, I think this person is anonymous, but I will have to ask them to clarify, because Pathways is, it's something through like the behavioral health office, but then also there's a Pathways that's a transitional housing provider. So Pathways, if it's something, Heather, that doesn't necessarily click right off the bat, then we do need more detail, because Pathways can mean a number of different things in Pennsylvania. Yeah. So if that person's still on, please add that information. Then Leslie's asking, cash assistance is not currently available for single individuals, correct? Only TANF for families?
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question?
Cash assistance is not currently available for single individuals, correct? Only TANF for families?
We have the TANF program, so that's based on the need of a child. So that's available for the TANF program is temporary assistance for needy families. So there would have to be a child who is deprived of support in some way in that household. We don't have the general assistance that would be for like a single adult that's disabled anymore. They discontinued that program, but we do have a refugee cash assistance program. Okay. So those are the two cash programs that we have in effect right now.
Heather?
Yeah.
You also can do a single pregnant woman.
Yes. Yes. The single pregnant
woman. She would also have the need of a child.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Thank you, Stacey, for clarifying. If someone is not working and waiting for SSI to be approved, do they qualify for cash assistance?
That would have been the general assistance program that we had at one point, but that was discontinued. Yeah.
Got it. Okay. If someone is homeless and trying to apply for disability, a little different. If someone is homeless and trying to apply for disability, can they apply for cash until they wait until they receive their disability?
It would only be if they met the TANF criteria. So if they were pregnant, then they could apply and be reviewed for it. If they had dependent children who were deprived, so that would also be kind of along the same lines.
Okay, great. How are you verifying that someone only has one car in order to qualify for the assistance with purchasing a car?
They have to have no car. They cannot have a car if we're going to do a vehicle purchase for TANF.
I guess they're wondering, like, how do you verify that?
Well, if we have nothing on record and we don't, like, we're not going to look up DMV records if that's what they're asking. You know, if there's nothing on that record and they report we've never had any information to the contrary that they've ever had a car on their record, then, you know, we could go ahead with that.
Okay. What is the best way to assist someone with accessing funds allotted for emergency shelter allowances? Our organization puts cost shares together daily to keep veterans from being evicted.
Can you rephrase that first part? Because I want to make sure I answer it.
Yep. What is the best way to assist someone with accessing the funds allotted for emergency shelter allowances?
Oh, okay. Okay, great. So you're an agency that does work with getting that supplemental to prevent like eviction or something like that. The best way to assist them with getting that emergency shelter allowance would be if you know that they need that help and they come to you and there's an extra amount of money, help them to have the verification in hand that you can help with so much money that they can take to the county assistance office to have that already. That would expedite the process. I think you're on mute, Helen, accidentally.
Yes. Can emergency shelter allowances be used to pay for a hotel room? We don't have a woman's or family shelter. Does that go back to the $100 that you mentioned?
Absolutely. Yep, that would be temporary shelter. And I actually did one of those myself because I could not get, I had a woman and her two children come into the office who had stayed on the street for the night. There was domestic violence involved and they were thrown out of the house. And she had pending criminal charges, so she couldn't get into the homeless shelter. So we were actually able to issue the emergency shelter allowance to put her up in a hotel. Yeah.
Okay. Someone is asking, what is the reason behind not being able to buy hot food in the grocery store?
I can't really answer that one. That would be an FNS. That's just per the FNS. That's the U.S. Department of Agriculture and Food and Nutrition Services. I don't know if anybody else on here from DHS has a better answer than that. I can't give the rationale behind that.
Actually, the rationale behind it is price.
Okay.
It's much more expensive to buy a chicken cooked at a hot case than it is to buy a chicken raw and cook it at your house. So what they're trying to do is get people the most bang for their buck out of their food stamps, which is why we have the food stamps for homeless people that can be a little different because they are lacking the ability to cook certain foods.
Thank you, Stacy. Much appreciated.
Anytime. That's why I'm here.
Let's see. Someone made a comment. Melissa made the comment. ESA also counts against the amount you get for HAP in a 24-month period. So that's just more of a statement, not a question.
Yeah.
Okay. So we have made it through all 77 prompts in our Q&A, plus whatever was in the chat, I believe. If you have something in the chat that went unnoticed, drop it in again real quickly because we missed it. There was just way too much going on in the chat, but we tried our best to keep up. And is there an appeal process for denial of ESA?
I think any decision that we make can be appealed.
Okay.
Yeah, any decision. That's why we send out the notices. Any kind of notice that we send out to anybody is going to give them instructions on how to appeal that decision.
Okay, and then Leslie just put in, what about hot meals for people experiencing homelessness who don't have the means to heat up food?
It can be used in, I'm trying to get the exact words for that.
So she's saying using SNAP in that instance would be helpful.
Yeah, it would definitely be. Wouldn't be able to be in like a retailer, but again, like if it was like something like in a homeless shelter or something like that, that would probably be the option for there. But we couldn't like grant an exception for that or anything in Pennsylvania right now, as our policies allow.
Okay.
It's just basically what is allowed under food stamp programs.
Got it.
Yeah, great we question. Can't make it would be great if we could make exceptions for different cases, but unfortunately, well, not unfortunately, but the FMS kind of, they give us clear directions on what can be purchased, and they regulate what can be purchased, so we can't really have any say over that.
Okay, great. It does look like we got through everything. Nothing else has come in. Heather's email was put in the chat. Oh, there is a comment, but in a shelter or soup kitchen, you aren't paying for food, but at Walmart or Giant, they could grab an already made food item that's hot. Yes, understood.
Yes, they can take that up with food stamp policy. That's not Department of Human Services.
Okay, well, you've been given a wealth of knowledge from Stephanie and Stacey and, of course, Heather today. This has been a very long recording, so I don't know how long it'll take. Let me stop, actually. I'll stop recording. Stop. Make sure you want to...